Bye bye, Miss American Pie. Drove the Chevy to the levee, but the levee was dry. Breakfast with Bob.
And Pacho Man, welcome to day three, Breakfast with Bob. My name is Bob Babbitt. We're brought to you by Hoka One One, Polar, Halo Neuroscience, Velofix, Today's Plan, Normatec, Four Seasons Resort, Hualalai, Triathlete Magazine, and we're here at beautiful Huggo's on the Rocks. Our next guest, we're only talking the first above-knee amputee woman to finish the Ironman Triathlon World Championship. Please give it up for Sarah Reinertsen.
Thank you. Thanks, Bob.
How you doing, Sarah?
I'm good.
It has been a while since you've been back here racing. 2004, right, was that first time here, and we'll chat about that with our audience here. So 2004, you out of nowhere, you decided you want to do a triathlon, you want to do the Ironman. When did that come about?
Well, I was inspired by another challenged athlete, a guy named Jim McLaren, who had done this race on a prosthetic leg, and I figured if he could do it, maybe I could do it too. And that was really my inspiration to come here and show that a girl with a prosthetic leg could conquer Kona too.
Well, and talk a little bit about when you talk about conquer Kona. As a little girl who lost your leg, congenital, right, above the knee, how hard was it as a little girl just to play sport? Girls in sport back then, a little bit, it was hard to have opportunity. A girl missing a leg, less opportunity.
Yeah, I grew up in a time where it was tough for a kid with a disability to find their way in sport. I grew up in a time when we didn't have Google to like look up things like that and find, you know, disability kid sports. And so, but my parents did treat me like any other kid. They made me play and they signed me up for soccer and stuff. But I really struggled in the team sports. And so that's where I gravitated to the individual sports. And I didn't have role models because the people on TV didn't look like me. I didn't know that I could be an athlete. That's why when I met Jim McLaren, who was also missing his leg like I was, he instantly became this role model, this mentor, and I just thought, I want to be like him. I want to do the Ironman like him. And that really changed my life. It was really important because I went to school every day wearing my prosthetic leg. I was the only one in the entire school that had that disability. And so I did feel very alone. So when I met him and met other people that were like me, it changed my life.
And Jimmy, when he lost his leg below the knee, Jim McLaren, he ran a 3:16 marathon with a prosthetic leg back in, you know, in the late 80s, and then he came here and went 10:42, which really changed perception about someone could do with a prosthetic leg. And so Sarah started out with running,
yep,
doing marathons, broke world records for a woman as a single above knee amputee in the marathon, the half marathon, all of that. And when you decided to do triathlon, did you own a bike? Could you swim?
I called myself a Marco Polo swimmer. I didn't really know how to swim laps or do a flip turn. I didn't know how to swim really, and I didn't know how to ride a bike. But again, I just having that role model, I just figured it's logistics. If he figured it out, I'd figure it out too. But yeah, I didn't learn to ride a bike until I was almost 30 years old.
Wow. And when did the Ironman enter into your life in terms of just the thought of it?
I actually started thinking about it, though, when I was 17. That's when I met Jim. So I had graduated high school, and that's, you know, just his inspiration. It really changed the trajectory of my life. I just was driven by this race, and then I became a little obsessed. I would, like, record the Ironman show every year on NBC, and I would watch it over and over, and I'd look at what they wore and what they ate and how they looked and how they dressed. I mean, I just knew this place was really calling me, and then I signed up for a half marathon here, and I flew to Kona and came out here, and I did a half marathon, and I thought, oh, my God, 13 miles. How am I going to do 140 miles? But I just knew it was possible, and I just stayed focused on that.
And when you came here in 2004, right, out of the water, great, on the bike, doing okay, a little bit of a stomach thing going on. I remember watching you on the Queen Highway. It was like pedal puke, pedal puke, pedal puke. That was a tough last 40 miles of that bike ride.
Well, that's the thing with Ironman. I think a lot of folks, you know, when you're in the community, you know it's not just swim, bike, running, but there is that fourth event, and that's nutrition.
Yeah.
And getting that down and really figuring out what you can eat on the bike. And so that was something I hadn't quite figured out, was the best nutrition on the day. And we had a pretty windy year as well that year.
You mean it was windy and hot here in Hawaii?
Yeah, but it was particularly windy. I mean, I've always heard it was like 65 mile an hour winds that year. Yeah. And so I knew to expect some winds, but they did just sort of beat me down. And then I had the nutrition issues.
And then you come in at the end of the bike and knowing, you know, I'm sure you knew at that point you had missed the bike cutoff time.
Yeah, no, I knew. I mean, I saw my watch obsessively. I was checking all day, and I knew that I was about 14 minutes too late. And I actually remember you were the one who greeted me when I came into transition, and I was told I was too late, and you gave me a Hawaiian lei. And it's so funny that I'm getting emotional about it, because, like, I know it has a happy ending, but, you know, there is that. A lot of these pros, I have been listening to all your podcasts and your interviews, but I know that when I start this race, there's no guarantees I'm going to make the cutoff.
Right.
And so it's a very different ball game. You know, like, I'm not looking for first, second, third, or even 10th place. I just want to finish this thing. And for me, the margins are very slim.
Yes.
And so, you know, I'm out there pedaling on one leg. I only get about 10% of the power out of my left prosthetic leg. So it's that one, my one right leg is just powering all day. But I've done the work, but I just, there are no guarantees. And so that is it does feel a little different to dive in to this race on Saturday. And I know that I can finish. I just need to have ideal conditions for it all to come together.
So when you don't make the cutoff time in 2004, I remember you were a woman on a mission, right? It was unfinished business, and I have a soundbite that we run fairly frequently on the radio show that Iron Man became the most high-maintenance boyfriend I've ever had in my life. And you were obsessed. You needed to get back here and come across that finish line.
Yeah, no, I was. I came to the island after I DNF'd in 2004. In 2005, I came to this island three times to train. I raced here. I mean, I missed my dad's wedding so that I could get a training workout in. I really was truly singularly focused and obsessed on doing this race. But I also knew that I needed to make those short-term sacrifices to reach my long-term goal of becoming an Ironman. And so those sacrifices paid off. But it's not always easy to make those sacrifices.
So you come back. I mean, you come to the finish line, coming down Ali'i Drive. Mike Riley's down there. And this, like you said, you've been committed. This is a 12-month commitment. Now you're coming down Ali'i Drive. What's going through your head?
Oh, it was like my whole body was sort of floating. Like, I couldn't believe that I was actually at the finish line. And I used to say that I was going to kind of walk and savor that finish line, but I couldn't. I just had to run. I was just like flying across that line. It was an amazing feeling to come across that line and finally hear Mike Riley say those words that I had been dreaming about for 12 years, actually. And when he called me an Ironman, it was amazing.
So from there, you end up on the Amazing Race, and you end up on a cover of Runner's World, and the number one requested issue of Runner's World of all time, the number one selling cover of Triathlete magazine of all time, spokesperson for Challenge Athletes Foundation, and everything else you're doing. It's 13 years later, and you decide, well, I think I want to come do the Ironman again. What the heck is wrong with you?
Well, you know, I actually just did this race in January and February of this year.
Yes.
It's called the World Marathon Challenge, where you do seven races on seven continents in 7 days. And so I figured if I could run that many consecutive races, I had enough miles in me. And after achieving that accomplishment, no amputee, male or female, had ever done the World Marathon Challenge. So when I achieved that, I kind of went through that post-event like funk where
what's
you're like,
next?
Now what? Like, yay, I did it, but like, now what? And so I had kept looking at the Ironman website. like obsessively every day. And I'm like, oh, it's the 40th anniversary. And I didn't even tell my husband, but I put my name in the lottery.
The PC lottery.
Because we have to qualify a little differently. Right. We have a lottery. And so I put my name in the lottery and I didn't even tell him. And I was like, okay, if I get in, then I'll tell him. And if I don't, like, no harm, no foul. So I put my name in because I was like, I got a lot of miles in me. It's a good base of training. And sure enough, actually, you called me. And the first person to call me, and you were like, so, you're going to Kona. And I got it, and I was like, okay, crap, I got to tell my husband we're going to Kona. So here we are.
And dealing with the fact that you have a prosthetic leg, and then your other leg is your motor.
Yeah.
You've been dealing with some injuries. How tough has this been just getting here? Because you've been doing most of your cycling indoors. Running, you have to be at a minimum.
Yeah, no, I mean, it is 13 years later. I'm now in my 40s. Like, I'm officially in the master's division. Ooh, I'm like, when did that happen? Yeah. But yeah, I've got arthritis in my foot. I actually got a stress fracture after I qualified at Santa Rosa, or like a pre-stress fracture. So I've only been cleared to run for the past 2 to 3 weeks. So I'm going into this race with a whole lot of swimming, a ton of cycling. I did all my cycling pretty much on the kicker, on the on Zwift, and using that Wahoo kicker. But my longest run is 50 minutes, I think, going into this race. But, like, thank God I just did that marathon race. So I lean into the fact that I know I can get through it. But my body is starting to break down a little bit. I have used that one leg and I've used it well, but I've got arthritis, I've got other issues in the foot. So I'm going to savor this because I don't know how long my body's going to hold up. It just needs to hold up through October 13th.
So this might be one of your last marathons.
This is probably going to be my last marathon.
Ladies and gentlemen, how about give it up for the amazing Sarah Reinertsen.
Bob, Miss American Pie. It's Breakfast with Bob.
Hi, gentlemen.